ఇతితే జ్ఞానం అఖ్యాతం గుహ్యాత్ గుహ్యతరమ్మయ విమృశ్యాత్ ఓకే యజేతత్ అశేషేణ యథేచ్ఛసి తథా. ఇట్ ఇస్ అప్లైస్ టు ఈవెన్ అవర్ లెక్చర్ ఆల్సో. దిస్ ఈస్ ది స్టేట్ ఆఫ్ ద ఆర్ట్ నాలెడ్జ్ అబౌట్ ద టాపిక్. దేర్ ద టాపిక్ ఈస్ ఆత్మజ్ఞాన, హియర్ ద టాపిక్ ఇస్ రాస్. ఆఖ్యాతం గుహ్యాత్ గుహ్యతరం మయా, వెరీ ప్రొఫౌండ్ దట్ హెస్ బీన్ టోల్డ్ బై మీ ఓకే ఇన్ భగవద్గీత. విమృశాత్ యు డిస్కస్ అబౌట్ దిస్ ఇన్ యువర్ మైండ్ ఏతః అశేషేణ ఇన్ ఎ వెరీ గ్రేట్ వే. దెన్ యథేచ్ఛసి తథా కురు, డూ యాజ్ పర్ దై బీడింగ్, యాజ్ పర్ వాట్ యు అండర్స్టాండ్. ఇట్ డజంట్ అప్లై టు అస్, సో యు హావ్ టు రీడ్, reflect and then utilize that knowledge in our furthering of any knowledge. Okay. Oh, now, okay, yeah, that is the Gita sloka. And of course, AC inhibition beyond BP control. You must know, AC inhibitor. Okay, BP, BP. No, not at all. That is not, there's only one small aspect is hypertension control. There's much to learn beyond BP control. This we call it as, this is available on our website www.drsarmu.in. This week name it as pleiotropic effects of ACIs and ARBs. Pleiotropic multiple effects beyond BP control. Okay. Now tension, today's lifestyle is full of tension, mental tension, and then angiotension. That all results into angiotensinogen, angiotensin 1, angiotensin 2. Angio is blood vessel, tension is constriction. Blood vessel damage, tension is not only constriction, it is damage to the blood vessel, is angiotension. Angiotension, don't think only blood pressure. The blood vessel is the largest endocrine organ in the body, is the endothelium. Today, entire vascular health and systemic health, tissue health is dependent upon the integrity of the vasculature. And that is being damaged and in a way by the angiotensin. Then why it is there? It's required to start with to protect against fall of blood pressure, fall of sodium. But ultimately what happens? If it overdoes the job, it produces problems, okay? Atherosclerotic vascular disease because of angiotension, and then you have end stage renal diseases, end stage cardiac diseases, end stage liver diseases, ED is end stage disease, and most importantly, erectile dysfunction. Tell me about the erectile function, I will tell you about your vascular health. Tell me the erectile dysfunction, we can tell about the vascular health. So every patient must elicit the history of erectile dysfunction. ED is equal to ED. ED is erectile dysfunction, is probably equal to endothelial dysfunction. There's a talk by me, ED is equal to ED, one can look into that. Okay, there is a paradigm shift in the understanding BP control, coronary artery disease, myocardial infarction, atrial fibrillation, and then LVH, heart failure, LV diastolic dysfunction, diabetes mellitus, new DDM, then macroalbuminuria, CKD, and prevention of stroke. These are all not different diseases. Today, they're all based on the same soil hypothesis, common soil hypothesis, called the overactivity of the ROS and damage to the vascular endothelium.
Yes,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah, these are what we are seeing, and tension, angiotensin, all that. Pleiotropic effects, we said, ACE beyond BP control, then the pleiotropic effect, then the angiotensin, then that results in what is called the atherosclerotic vascular disease, that results in ED, which is end stage disease, or endothelial dysfunction is equal to erectile dysfunction. There's a paradigm shift in understanding BP control, CAD, MI, AF, LVH, heart failure, diastolic dysfunction, new onset diabetes, macroalbuminuria, CKD, and of course preventing the stroke. All these have a common soil hypothesis. That is the endothelial dysfunction is the hallmark of all these things. And this endothelial dysfunction is again managed by several systems. One among them is the RAS system. So renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, the master regulator of human physiology, no doubt about it. Inhibition of RAS is called RASi. So your RASi depends upon RAS inhibition. How much inhibited is the RAS? That is the RASi. Its inhibition has pleiotropic multiple effects, and RAS inhibition is mainly four types. Now, ACE1 angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, ARBs, aldosterone antagonists, renin inhibitors, aliskiren, several new drugs are there. So let us see one by one. So angiotensinogen, you have already put, this is a very basic slide for anybody to understand. Angiotensinogen is a protein. It's a sequence of amino acids converted into the pink color angiotensin 1 and then angiotensin 2, which is the red color one. If at all there is a dangerous molecule on the globe, this is one among them. The other one is thrombin. Thrombin and angiotensin 2 can just are two time moment bombs which can destroy the whole world. Thrombin and angiotensin 2. But nonetheless, they are useful too in smaller quantities. So from the liver, angiotensin, it is a globular, means a folded protein. And that folded protein has to be opened up like a chain for it to be activated. And that is the renin. GGA apparatus will produce the renin, and that unfolds it and makes it into a 10 amino acid long decapeptide, and then two more amino acids are cut and by the enzyme ACE produced from the lungs. So that results in octapeptide, which is our central molecule, angiotensin 2. We will refer to this as AT2, capital 2, that is Roman 2, AT2. So when I use small one or ordinary Arabic 1 and 2, it is different. AT2 is the principal hormone, which is the central molecule produced by the action of renin and ACE, as shown in the slide. Okay. Now, AT2 we have got. What does this do? It can act on AT1, AT2, and AT4. AT3 activity is aldosterone. AT3, it produces the action to generate aldosterone. So AT3 is via the aldosterone. That is why we have put it on this side. So this is via the AT small 3. These numerals as a suffix, they tell about the receptor on which the angiotensin 2 acts. Angiotensin capital 2 is the central molecule. It acts on several receptors, suffixed as 1, 2, 3, and 4. Acting on angiotensin 1 is a harmful vasoconstrictor, proliferative, then smooth muscle contraction, then prothrombotic, pro-inflammatory, and all nonsense. All detrimental things are AT1. Then it is counterbalanced by the receptors called AT2. Stimulation of them is beneficial, and we have a molecule. This molecule acts also on the AT4, which is beneficial. Okay, so one which acts on AT1 and AT2, and some people are joining. Okay, so remember this slide. So we have the ARBs are the drugs which block this one. They don't do anything for AT2 or AT4 or aldosterone. So ARBs basically act there. Now understand, these are very intricate slides. All of you should concentrate now where it is easily available. So AT2 receptor has got a chance to act on AT1, endothelin receptor, or alpha-1 receptor on the cell. And it has also got the chance to act on a protective receptor called the AT2 receptor. So acting on the AT1 receptor is detrimental. Acting on the AT2 is protective. Then we have the AT4 receptor, which is on the smooth muscle cell there, and that is the one antifibrinolytic, and that is again 84 receptor expression is dependent upon the levels of A1 angiotensin 1 and 2, their conversion by the PAAI1. Okay, so 81 is important, 82 is important, 84 is important, 81 is vascular negative, vascular negative, 82 is vasoprotective, 84 is also vasoprotective, antifibrinolytic, that's what we learned. Okay, now let us come back to where we are with the places where we can interfere. AGTNG, angiotensinogen, is converted by the ACE down into angiotensin 1, which is manufacturing the angiotensin 2 by the ACE enzyme here. And this conversion is by the renin, we know that. So angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1 is the renin, and then ACE acts on that, renin produces this, and renin acts on this, and this is converted by the ACE, and you have a powerful drug to group of drugs to block that. There is also ACE2 pathway, and that through that also some amount of 81 can be produced. So not only that, you have the renin pathway, there's an extra renin pathway to produce it, and that can also produce angiotensin. Now you have got ACE2, which can cleave the 1 into 1,7 or 1,9. So from here it is 1,7,9, from here it is 1,7. So if this is used, we have got 1,7,9. If this pathway is used, 1,7,9. This is a new understanding about the ACE2. Now, do we have drugs on that? We come to that. Now, what are the non-ACE pathways? TTPA pathway, that is the tissue thromboplastin pathway, cathepsin pathway, tonins, elastase. This is what that article is showing. The chymase pathway, and very important today is the chymase pathway and the cage pathway. What is that cage? We have seen that. Now you see here, the angiotensinogen has come into the system. It is there from the liver, and then direct you have got a conversion to angiotensin 1 and then to angiotensin 2. Now, can we interfere with this? Yes, direct renin inhibitors, aliskiren. Aliskiren is the drug which is a direct renin inhibitor, and pronenin to renin receptor to renin, direct renin inhibitor, it hits on the renin and doesn't allow it to function, do its function to convert angiotensin, tensinogen to angiotensin 1. Thereby, all the negative effects of angiotensin 2 are stopped by this. This is mechanism 1, the highest level of it. Okay, at the second level, which is the most commonly used, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor, ACE inhibitor, and that is the one which acts and reduces the angiotensin 2, but in the process, it will not allow the bradykinin degradation. So bradykinin accumulation occurs, and that is responsible for your cough, ACE cough. You must know that. So the usually bradykinin is made into inactive peptides, and bradykinin levels are there because this enzyme is blocked. Bradykinin increases, that produces the cough, and then little bit of irritation in the lung due to the bradykinin there. Okay, now we have got drugs which block this, that is the ARBs, which block the angiotensin 2 itself. This we know, it has got an action on the 81, and the 82, and the 84, and the 83, which are through the 83 to the aldosterone. So what happens? There is another pathway called the ACE pathway that can produce angiotensin 1, and all this down it can go. Now, if we have drugs to block the ACE2, we will have the fourth level of blocking. And okay, so let us say the angiotensin 1 is formed, and there are angiopeptides. These are converted into aldosterone, and thus aldosterone acts on the aldosterone receptors. We have drugs here to block the aldosterone conversion, and we have drugs here to block the aldosterone receptor. This one slide will explain, and another we have another pathways, the non-chymase pathways are there, that is the cage pathway, through that the angiotensin 1 can become angiotensin 2, and that can also be blocked. This is the pathway number 7. You see here how the science has changed from simple blocking of the angiotensin converting enzyme, the first step, to renin inhibitors, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, angiotensin 2 blockers, now the ACE2 blockers, then the angiopeptidase blockers, aldosterone receptor blockers, non-ACE chymase blockers. And here we have newer drugs in the pipeline which directly act on the AT1, AT2, and AT4. And maybe when you start teaching, after you become teachers, you'll be talking about at the receptor level also, there are drugs coming up. Okay. Now, to make that complicated diagram very simple, so there is a renin angiotensin here, and this renin angiotensin, angiotensinogen, elascarin is the drug, AT1 level, ACE enzyme is the enzyme, ACE inhibitor. At the angiotensin 2 level, it should not act on the AT1 receptor, which is a detrimental receptor, that is the ARB, and through the mineralocorticoid receptor, the renal. And this acts in turn, when you can reduce the activity here, and there is what a 2-82 receptor, 84 receptor, this activity will be more because the angiotensin 2 is now available, not allowed to go towards the 81. It comes towards the 82, and thereby the beneficial effect. So let's say there are 81 receptor is there, 82 receptor is there, 84 receptor is there. And I am not allowed to go touch this because I have been blocked by the ARB. Then I am angiotensin 2 and I am available now to go to the other houses. These houses are very friendly houses. Through them, vasoprotection can occur. Okay. And at this level, if ACE is blocked, it blocks the bradykinin metabolism. In the result, bradykinin excess will be there. Bradykinin, the very name suggests, is vasoprotective. Brady is always good. Tacky is dangerous. So bradykinin, in terms of its kinetic activity on the vasculature, it reduces the intensity of the effects. So it is vasoprotective. So this ACE inhibitors, by increasing the bradykinin, they are vasoprotective. ARB is by increasing the availability of angiotensin capital 2 to act on receptor 2 and 4, they are vasoprotective. And also the mineralocorticoid ones. See how nice these things are. So a little word about the bradykinin pathways. There are what are called the plasma kallikrein kininoges are there. Out of them, bradykinin is an important one. And vasoactive kinins, kinin is one, and kininase 2 is nothing but the ACE. So bradykinin is inactivated by kininase 1 and ACE, which is the kininase 2. When we block the ACE, the bradykinin excess will occur. That produces a very beautiful cardioprotective and vasoprotective effect. A slight side effect, the ACE cough, and little angioedema also is because of the bradykinin. What are the two side effects? Angioedema and then cough, ACE cough. These are mediated by bradykinin. Okay, this is a very important thing that to some extent brought out by our friend, the juxtaglomerular apparatus there. They sense the sodium level and they sense the blood pressure. They sense the sympathetic activity. There are three stimuli, one low sodium, two the sympathetic activity, three low blood pressure, they stimulate the juxtaglomerular apparatus, they pour in the renin into the blood, and that renin goes to the liver and acts to produce AT2 from angiotensin, tensinogen through the ACE pathway, involvement of the lung there for the ACE enzyme. This AT2 is a vasoconstrictor, not only in there, it also constricts here the efferent artery. And the efferent artery is constricted, there's an increase in the juxtaglomerular pressure. Increase in the juxtaglomerular pressure increases the filtration. That increases the excretion of fluid and excretion of sodium into that. And that sodium has to be brought back through the aldosterone, so ATA2. So when you use AT to blockers, the efferent arterioles relax. There is no glomerular damage. There is no increase in the intraglomerular pressure. There is no excess sodium here to be absorbed. Aldosterone's job becomes better. And this also acts to the insulin excess. AT2 produces insulin excess. And through the insulin pathway, sodium pump is affected. Today we know RAS system is very useful in diabetes. We have the sartans, which act not only on the blood pressure, which have also act on the diabetes through the PPAR gamma receptors. And now this is a summary slide. The first one level is the angiotensinogen, be converted into angiotensin 1. So the action of renin, decrease in the renal perfusion, sodium level, and beta 1 receptors all produce it. Then the lung supplies the enzyme ACE. And this is the central molecule. So that is the central molecule. Through this, it increases the SNS activity. It increases the tubular sodium and chloride resorption, and so much so water retention and edema. It adrenocortical vasoconstriction, arteriolar vasoconstriction through the ADH from the pituitary acts on the collecting duct where the ADH acts and retains water. So what are the four mechanisms? One, SNS activity is increased, which is dangerous to the system in the long run. Number two, tubular sodium resorption and then potassium excretion are increased, which retains sodium, again expands the extracellular volume. And third, this is through the adrenal gland. It acts, this is direct, and also through the Aldo, it acts. That is the third level. The fourth one is potent vasoconstrictor, arteriolar vasoconstriction. And fifth one is through the pituitary. It acts on the collecting duct and retains water. These are the five different mechanisms through which angiotensin II, which is the central hormone, produces various vascular and cardiovascular effects. SNS activity, direct action on the tubules to resorb sodium and potassium, action through the adrenal cortex, through the aldosterone, extra sodium and retention and excretion of potassium. And fifth, arteriolar vasoconstriction. Sixth one will be through the ADH secretion, through the pituitary. All this havoc is caused. And for all these things, the receptor molecule is AT1. So the receptor substrate, this receptor for the substrate is the AT1. Okay. Now, kidney produced renin, again came angiotensin, angiotensin 1, ACE, angiotensin 2. Now, adrenal cortex, one mechanism, pituitary, another mechanism, through the aldosterone retains this one, through the ADH retains sodium and fluid, and it stimulates the thirst in the hypothalamus, increases the blood volume, it stimulates the vasoconstriction, it stimulates the cardiac hypertrophy. All these are, in the initial stages, are protective only. When the blood pressure is falling, when the sodium is low, and the blood volume is low, this is helpful. But you know, sustained activity of the AT2 uninhibited activity is vasodetrimental. That is what we have learned. Now, another thing is the AT2 acts on the stretch also. The stretch causes endothelins. These endothelins are very important growth factors. And through the AT1 receptors, it increases the, proliferation of the vascular smooth muscle, causes vasoconstriction. Okay, and also acts on the cardiac myocytes and produces what is called cardiac hypertrophy and cardiac remodeling, which are not good for the heart. This is the cause of diastolic dysfunction. The diastolic dysfunction you see is because of the action of the angiotensin II on the cardiac myocytes. So on the afferent arteriole, there is a positive effect. It increases the pressure here. With the result, the force with which the blood comes here is increased. That increases the filtration. Acts more on the efferent, blocks the efferent constriction. Again, increases intraglomerular pressure, more filtration of fluid and sodium. And that has to be brought back, a lot of strain on the aldosterone mechanism. And they go through the growth factors also. Now, This is the kininogen bradykinin protective pathway. So this is all 88, through the 81, it is all dangerous. And through the vasculature, through the heart, through the kidney, the bradykinin pathway is the protective pathway, because BK2 receptors, they increase the bradykinin there. Once the bradykinin is there, definitely it is protective. That's why when we block ACE, we allow bradykinin to be more, that bradykinin is vasoprotective. Now, this is what he's talking about, the macula densa, the ascending limb of the loop of the Henle. This is the macula densa part. And then the 82, ACTH, potassium. These are powerful stimulators of aldosterone. And once 82 is there, aldosterone, ACTH, directly from the pituitary. Potassium levels, more potassium levels, more aldosterone to throw out the potassium in exchange, retain this one. What does this do? This is not a simple molecule. This is a very dangerous molecule. Increases LVH, increases atrial fibrillation, increases fibrosis, and then heart failure worsens, increases vascular resistance and blood pressure. And all this is because, one, through the mechanism of increasing the sodium resorption through non-sodium actions of aldosterone, non-renal actions of aldosterone on the heart, for the LVH, for the myocardial fibrosis, for the arrhythmia, atrial fibrillation, on the blood vessels directly. So aldosterone through the sodium retains water and sodium, and non-renal mechanisms of aldosterone. And this aldosterone, remember, is stimulated by our central molecule ACE2. So if we block the ACE2, we can block all the detrimental effects of aldosterone. Now, beta blockers, ACE inhibitors are protective because they lessen the wall stress and prevent the remodeling. In the absence of beta blocker, in the absence of ACE inhibition, there's increased wall stress, LV dilatation, LV remodeling, LV failure, LV aneurysms. That is why the cornerstone of heart failure treatment is ACE or AR, because we don't want the cardiac remodeling to occur and increase the wall stress. Now, this is a little genetics of the ACE enzyme, ACE double dose, that is a homozygous, heterozygous, and ACE2. There is an intron 16 of 287 base pair of the ALA repeat sequence. This is genetics. Why I wanted to know about that? Because the angiotensin converting enzyme expression is not uniform across all people. The ACE expression in you will be very different from the ACE expression in one. That is the reason some people have a very accelerated cardiovascular disease. Some people do not have it even when they are 60s or 70s. Is it genetic? Yes. Can it be modified? Yes. Diet and exercise will not allow the ACE to express very much and keep the ACE enzyme levels itself at a lower level. So it is both nature and nurture too. That is why another thing is the African race, the expression of ACE is not there. The ACE is not expressed in them. With the result, you cannot use ACE inhibitors in them as the primary drug. The Negroid race as a whole, they don't have good expression of ACE. In our population too, some of us do not have good expression of ACE. For them, these drugs will not be useful, and they're rapid progressors in terms of cardiovascular disease. So what does it boil down to, all these diagrams? The effect of my heart, my coronaries, my kidney, adrenals, and on the coagulation front. Myocardial hypertrophy, interstitial fibrosis, inotropic effects, heart remodeling. Coronaries, endothelial dysfunction, decreased nitric acid, coronary vasoconstriction, oxidative stress, inflammation, proatherotic atheroma. On the kidneys, intraglomerular pressure at the afferent, more on the afferent. Increased proteinuria because pressure is more, protein starts leaking, and when sodium resorption has to be more, glomerular growth factors and fibrosis are produced whenever there is high pressure in the glomerulus. Growth factors are stimulated. They slowly the glomeruli become fibrotic, and then vessels are thickened and thickened, and it acts through the ADH also. This intraglomerular pressure stimulates the ADH again. Adrenals, increased aldosterone, augmented SNS. Adrenals are, I told you, multifarious effects. It goes through the SNS also. And coagulation, increase in the fibrinogen, increase in the PAI1, and platelet aggregation, which is again pro-atherogenic. Now, what are the chances I can interfere? This is step one. I can use ACE inhibitor to block this enzyme, or I can use 81 receptor blocker, the ARB. I can use aldosterone blockers like your spironolactone, or I can use mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. And of course, the renin also we have there. So many new mechanisms are there. The aldosterone on the kidney, I told you, these are the effects on the heart, on the blood vessel. Don't think aldosterone only, pulls sodium into the system. That is only a small effect of aldosterone, is to retain sodium. The major effect is on the renal proteinuria, renal failure, interstitial fibrosis, glomerulosclerosis. All are negative effects on the kidney. Then why aldosterone? Yes, it is required when the sodium is going down. It is the one which protects you. He has said this is a very helpful hormone. Yes, but in larger numbers. Ati sarvatra varjate. Anything in excess is dangerous. LVH, cardiac fibrosis, there will be dysfunction, heart failure on the endothelium. Endothelial dysfunction, low nitric oxide, endothelial inflammation, oxidative stress. Today, any vascular disease is endothelial disease. Hypertension, heart failure, myocardial infarction, stroke, diabetes, peripheral arterial disease are not different diseases. They are the various manifestations of the same disease. One is the Kumaraswamy Vigraha in Palani, the other is in some other place, the other is in your town, and all are the same faces. Six different faces of Lord Muruga or Kumaraswamy are the six different diseases. The underlying mechanism is only one. Endothelial dysfunction mediated by the ROS, mediated by the aldosterone, mediated by the sympathetic nervous system, mediated by the non-ACE pathway, and mediated by the KS pathway. Okay, mineralocorticoid antagonist, you have got eplerenone. The available brand name is eplerestat. Okay, bradykinin, I'm skipping this slide. Endothelium, we have to understand. You see on the left side, these are all the protective factors of the endothelium. And these are all the detrimental effects of endothelium. A beautiful balance is produced, and bradykinin is protective, and nitric oxide is protective, and then prostacyclins are protective, histamine is protective, substance P is protective. Here, A2 is detrimental, endothelin is detrimental, thromboxane A2 is detrimental, platelet-derived growth factors are detrimental, again endothelin, A2 again, superoxide dismutase, tumor necrosis factor alpha, all cell adhesion molecules and thrombotic factors. What happens when we have the ROS activity? This part is overworking and this is suppressed. And so much. So we have vascular ill health. Now coming to the endothelin. Endothelin is again cleaved by an enzyme, 39 amino acids, by the endothelin cleaving or converting enzyme to 21 amino acids, which is an active endothelin. There are three endothelins, endothelin 1, 2, and 3, and these have an effect. And they act on A receptor, B1 receptor, B2 receptor, particularly endothelin 1. And this is harmful, just like our AT2 activity. This is AT2 on the AT1 receptor is harmful. Like this, this is harmful. This is AT2 receptor protective, AT4 receptor. It is there. Like that is our ETRB1. They are helpful. And the actions on B2 are mixed. Okay. And so now that is why we have beautiful drugs. Endothelin antagonist, terusentan, cetuximab, Sucinton, Bosentan, use these drugs in pulmonary hypertension of whatever etiology, including primary pulmonary hypertension. The effect is on endothelium, on the heart, on the renal tubule, on the vascular smooth muscle cell. AT2, catecholamines, insulin, LDL, growth factors, stress, all potentiate the harmful effects of endothelin through the ETA receptor. What are the ones which potentiate? AT2, of course, catecholamines, sympathetic activity, insulin, hyperinsulinemia, diabetes, LDL, and growth factors, and stress all act through the endothelin 1 on the ETA receptor and produce harmful effects. If we use these drugs, we can block the harmful effects of the endothelins. Okay, so what are the major trials saying? This is all pathophysiology. Is it true in real world? Yes. See those trials, mortality benefit of 40%, and then you have got solved trial, 18%, solved protect P trial, 38%, X-solved 10%, VHFT 15%, then save around 35%, trace, you have got so much. Yeah, these are international trials which have shown that AC inhibition is very helpful. Not in one trial, these are half a dozen trials or more, all have shown vasoprotection and cardiac protection and renal protection. Now, there are other trials, there are another 20 trials I have listed here, all of them in one stroke. They have said they are very powerful. Okay, this I will skip. Genetic link of ROS, pleiotropic effects are because of ROS and CAD. There is a 5.3-fold. People who have more ROS activity, the CAD levels in them are much more. These are called phenotype A type of people. ACEI circulatory effects are cardioprotective. When you block those circulatory hemodynamic, neuroendocrine, and decrease in the endothelial dysfunction, anti-proliferative, anti-atherogenic, anti-thrombotic, positive tissue effects when we block the ACE enzyme. ACE enzyme blockage has all these protective effects. Why ACE is vasoprotective? Decreases AT2 and aldosterone, decreases AT2 in the endothelin in the kidney, and increases the vasodepressor bradykinin system, and that is all vasodepression means again protection, and decreases the SNS activity, anti-adrenergic, vagomimetic, which is opposite of sympathetic, anti-arrhythmic, and then normal heart rate is resumed. So these are various mechanisms. They will try to be helpful to us. And alteration in the prostanoid metabolism is also listed. Mechanisms of ACE benefit: arrhythmias are reduced, reperfusion and arrhythmias are reduced, cardiac remodeling, I have showed you how it is reduced, fibrinolysis, endogenous fibrinolysis, antihypertensive, anti-LVH, neurohormonal activation is inhibited, renal protection, antiproteinuria. The end result is vasodilatation, reduction in SNS, free radical scavenging, direct antiatherogenic effect, improvement in insulin sensitivity, neoangiogenesis also is thought of and then being experimentally proved that it may increase the new blood vessel formation and this one, whatnot, excellent benefits. So we have ACIs, ERBs, MRAs, three different categories of drugs. AC is beyond BP control, endothelial dysfunction, left ventricular systolic and diastolic dysfunction, IHD and MI, and new onset diabetes, and cardiometabolic risk reduction. With the result, you will have a smiling heart. And all these are taken care of. There is no cardiovascular or cardiac disease. So, what causes nephropathy in CKD in some people and not in some others? One, the AT gene itself. We know the genetic differences. We know the ACE gene. AT gene, ACE gene. And there is what is called the sodium lithium pump. These are not same in all the people. There is a genetic factor, which is sodium lithium pump, genetics, ACE gene genetics, AT gene. These expressions are varied in different people, which have a bearing on the CKD. Or there is a dysglycemia and hypertension. Even though the ACE activity is good, CKD can occur. The third mechanism if this person is a smoker, even if he has got a favorable genes, even if he doesn't have diglycemia and hypertension, still CKD can come. So where can I interfere? I cannot do much with this thing. Of course, I can control my dysglycemia and hypertension and stop smoking and protect my kidney. Isn't it? This is how you have to. And you know, if you see people are there, diabetic nephropathy, end-stage renal disease, 15% die of renal disease, 85% die of cardiovascular disease. They die in the coronary units, 85% of them, nephropathy people. They only 15% will go into renal failure and end-stage renal disease. Means what? Cardiovascular protection is the key for protecting the people from diabetic nephropathy, from stage one, not allowing them to stage two, three, and no matter whatever you do, it should be protecting the kidney in the first place. So these are various anti-hypertensive drugs. See the beautiful effects of ACE, every front, CHF, post-MI, CAD risk, diabetes, nephropathy, stroke prevention, plus ERBs, very much, but this is not worked out, whether they work on the stroke. CCB is only in this area, aldosterone antagonists here, beta blockers here, diuretics here. If I am asked to choose an antihypertensive drug, this must be the choice and not the other ones as the first one. Okay, and what is their effect on other aspects? ACARBs reduce dysglycemia, reduce dyslipidemia. CCBs are neutral, diuretics increase glycemia, new onset diabetes is more, they disturb the lipids, beta blockers increase dysglycemia, very much increase dyslipidemia, alpha blockers are neutral here, they increase dyslipidemia. Here is a group of drugs which is very favorable for me on the dysglycemia and dyslipidemia, and they must be the choice for that reason too, because today my vascular disease control is HbA1c control, and then B, blood pressure, C, cholesterol, the ABC. So A is A1c, B, blood pressure, C, cholesterol. And these are drugs which have positive effect on the A1c, on the cholesterol, and of course on the blood pressure. A must for vascular protection, because antihypertensive, vasoprotective, antithrombotic, anti-inflammatory, inevitable for a diabetic, more so when they have associated hypertension and CVD, reduce the CV even, reduce atherosclerosis, reduce renal disease, which is a strong risk factor. We said renal disease, 85% of them die in the coronary wards. Metabolically friendly drugs, as we have seen in the previous slide, prevent new onset DM, prevent nephropathy, well tolerated, few side effects. Okay, I should know what are when I should not use the contraindications. Contraindication in pregnancy. Okay, relative renal impairment, EGFR, microalbuminuria, proteinuria, previous MI, you know, you have to be a little cautious. And relative contraindications, bilateral renal artery stenosis, and then severe renal impairment, creatinine clearance, creatinine more than 3 in men and more than 2.5 in women. 2.5 for women of creatinine is as much as 3 for men. Monitor renal function whenever you use this drug. Angioedema, ACE cough can be problem. NSAIDs interact adversely. So do not use too much of NSAIDs whenever you are using ACE inhibitors. Of course, low dose aspirin is okay. That you need not stop for, because anyway the cardiac patient will be taking low dose aspirin. That has to be continued. So what are the indications finally? In heart failure, the number one drug. In hypertension, number one drug. In type 2 diabetes and angina pectoris, a very good add-on drug. And then acute myocardial infarction, post-myocardial infarction, very good drugs to combine with other drugs. Neuropathy, they are very useful. And then CM or cardiometabolic protection, you have to use ACE inhibitors. Stroke prevention, not ARBs, but ACEs, have to be used. These are the pleiotropic effects of blocking the RAS system. And ultimately, what not? It appears that they have multiple pathways. ACARBs are a must for vascular protection. Summary, RAS inhibition is central to cardiovascular disease. Effects on AT2, aldosterone must be countered. ARBs block AT1 receptor, AC side effects are avoided by using them, like the little cough and all. CHF cannot be managed without ACE inhibitor. Careful ACE selection. Hypotension, renal failure, and potassium is high. Yes, ARBs are early. Combine them with beta blockers, aldosterone. In heart failure, hypertension, ACE, ARB are effective. Monotherapy, you can add on diuretics or CCPs. Useful early phase of myocardial infarction and in the discharge prescription, you must have, just like the statin, an ACE inhibitor for heart failure, post-myocardial infarction. Excellent drugs for diabetes and non-diabetic nephropathy. ACARBs, no conclusive answer. Can you combine them? Theoretically, yes, because they are working in two different levels, but we don't have trials to support that you can combine both. So at the moment, we don't do that. We can use, but now we know ARBs can be combined with the naprilysin, which is the B-natriuretic peptide inhibitor. That is the sacubitril trials are there, and they can be used like that. So universal role of ACEs, we have already discussed all these things. So clinical contraindication, bilateral inguinal stenosis, pregnancy, absolute contraindication, both ACE/ARB. Hyperkalemia, contraindication. You just bring down the potassium and then start using. Renal failure, 2 or 2, 3 or 2.5, depending on the gender, relative contraindication. Angioedema, ACE contraindicated can be very handy. Cough due to ACE can be stopped. This can be very handy. In blacks, I told you, these are less effective because of the poor expression of ACE gene. So where from we got this information? National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, European Society of Hypertension, International Society of Hypertension, British Heart Society, National Kidney Foundation, American Diabetic Association are all the international resources to pull up this presentation. And I hope you have a very summary idea of what is ROS. So what are the drugs available? Prils, all prils are ACE inhibitors, lisinopril, quinapril, captopril, enalapril, perindopril. The king is the ramipril. A lot of trials and beautifully. If you want to use ACE inhibitor, use ramipril. So again, this is about the different prils and doses and all that. Then you have got the sartans, which are the ARBs, angiotensin II receptor blockers, valsartan, irbesartan, olmesartan, candesartan, telmisartan, losartan is the most studied drug. And now we have telmisartan, which is better than losartan in terms of the renal protective effect. Okay, these are again the dosages and where you can use it, or different sartans, a comparative idea. So clinical indications, heart failure, hypertension, nephropathy, non-diabetic nephropathy, LV diastolic dysfunction, I told you, this is the one drug which can treat diastolic dysfunction. Early phase of AMI, CV prophylaxis with increased risk factors. All these can be used. Practical points, sodium, potassium, creatinine to be measured. Start early, ARB as an alternative. Start low, titrate upward. Add 12.5 milligrams of hydrochlorothiazide. Watch for the ACE cough. Forget not to add statin. 75 milligrams of ACE should be given. Remember, chloride there. Absolute contraindication, CI. Monitor serum creatinine and potassium in these patients. Avoid NSAIDs. ACARBs are a must. Consider aldosterone antagonist in heart failure and renal failure. So this is a dual effect, both protective and that is preventive and curative, and that's the great boon that we have today. Now we have an unparalleled opportunity to prevent atherosclerotic disease, but only if we act. Otherwise, okay, this is the SARS-CoV virus. It is extracellular in the lung alveoli, and this is the pneumocyte, the alveoli. The previous slide will show the pneumocytes there. I did not copy here. Anyway, this is the slide. and this is the ACE2. You know ACE2 enzyme, no? That ACE2 enzyme expression is there on the surface. This virus goes and depletes the ACE2. It attacks the ACE2, and ACE2 is depleted in the cell surface due to virus internalization. What does it do? The virus tries to go inside, and while trying to go inside, it also folds these receptors, the ACE2 enzyme expression into inside. Okay, then what happens when ACE2 normally is there? ACE2 we know is important to convert angiotensin 2 into 1,7. That we have seen in the earlier slide. Angiotensin 2 is 1,8, isn't it? From that one more amino acid cleaving, ACE2 is cleaves and 1,7. That 1,7 acts on mass receptors. What are mass receptors? These MAS receptors are anti-inflammatory, anti-fibrotic, and vasodilating. Now what is happening? My COVID virus has stolen my angiotensin 2. Why? Because when ACE2 is there, then my angiotensin 2 can become angio-1,7. In the absence of ACE2, which is folded inside by the virus, the formation of my angiotensin 1,7 is not there. Naturally, the protective effects of mass receptors are absent. Not only that, this angiotensin 2 is detrimental. It acts on 81 receptors in the lung. It produces inflammation and fibrosis. If my ACE is there, it will cut this enzyme, this particular molecule, and turn into that. Now in the absence of ACE2, which is folded inside, my angiotensin 2 is available, and that is acting on the 81 receptor there. That 81 receptor we know is detrimental and damages. In addition, there is another pathway called the cytokines, the tumor necrosis factor, which are produced by the SARS virus. They act on the TNF-alpha receptor, and this in addition acts on the ADAM17. This ADAM17 expression will be more. And what does that do? That in now the COVID virus is internalized. Internalized COVID virus produces more ADAM17. What is ADAM17? ADAM17 is a molecule which has got the key for this particular cell, for the surface, and opens the key. ADAM1 opens the key. Okay, come in. Coronavirus, you come inside. See how bad it is. Our own fellow, ADAM1, which is again produced by TNF-alpha, 81, and this one, normally this, when this is suppressed, this is there to regulate the number of ACE receptors. Here it is working in a bad way, because it opens the key and come coronavirus, come inside. Coronavirus goes inside, and along with that, it takes the ACE2 receptors also inside. ACE2 expression is not there. Angiotensin 2 is not degraded to a useful molecule to act on the mass receptors. Angiotensin 2 is there, but acts on the 81 receptor and further increases the ADAM17. And in addition, the cytokines are there, all together cause necroinflammation and then fibrosis, vasoconstriction, and all havoc in the... Can you tell me why women are relatively more protected from coronavirus than men? You know, the expression of mass receptors is very much more in female gender. That is why the protective effect of angiotensin 1 is better utilized by them compared to men. That is the reason, the gender difference of coronavirus. The summary itself is quite interesting. Can you see the article, all of you?
Yes, sir.
You have that also. RAS system inhibition is one of the most powerful maneuvers to slow the progression of vascular disease and renal disease in particular. If you have nephropathy, the first drug that we think about is ACE inhibitor ARB. So it is a renoprotective effect is very much there. Vascular protective effect is there. Pleiotropic effects are there. Angiotensin 2 is the most important central molecule in the pathophysiology of cardiovascular disease. So what did we learn? RAS system is very important for slowing the progression of vascular damage and particularly renal damage, cardiac damage also. Angiotensin II is the central molecule. And then many other delayed dysfunctions are mediated by other factors like the TGF-beta, that is growth factor beta, tissue growth factor beta, and other chemoattractants that are there. Now we have got, apart from angiotensin II, latest research is on angiotensin IV and angiotensin III to some extent, IV to a greater extent. And also we have got the non-ACE pathways of metabolism of the system there, RAS system there. That is important. And also we have the AT2 receptor pleiotropy. That means, you know, AT2 receptor is not one. It is multiple types of AT2 receptors are there. And these may mean different things. Okay, this was how it was traditionally seen. The RAS system was considered as an endocrine system with angiotensin as the central molecule from the liver, as you have put it there. And then they cleaved by the juxtaglomerular renin to form the angiotensin 1. And again, from the lung enzyme, angiotensin converting enzyme becomes angiotensin 2. And that is the one which acts on the vessels, blood vessels, and also produces adrenocortical stimulation to produce the angiotensin, aminaldosterone. This is the classical view. So now you see this, maybe I'll enlarge this a bit. This is interesting for you to know. So all of you know how angiotensin 1 is produced, angiotensinogen, and the action of renin, which is from the JG cells, and then angiotensin 1. And this angiotensin has got two pathways. One pathway is to go to angiotensin 2, and from that is through the classical ACE pathway. And then maybe I'll use this. The classical pathway is the ACE pathway, through which it becomes the angiotensin 2. And as you can see, AT1, AT2, ATX, and AT1, AT2, this is angiotensin 3 from angiotensin 2, and then the 4, which is acting on the AT4 receptors. And these aminopeptidases convert the angiotensin 2 to act on aldosterone production. In addition to the ACE pathway, we have a very powerful pathway now, which we were not knowing earlier, which is called the chymase pathway. Okay, and then there is another enzyme called the ACE2, which converts the 10 peptide, 10 amino acid peptide into one. It cleaves only one amino acid, whereas this cleaves two amino acid and produces octapeptide. And this is a nanopeptide on this side, and which is further acted by the same enzyme, removes two more and produces what is called 1,7. So this is very important for you to understand the usefulness of ACE2 pathway, chymase pathway, the production of angiotensin 1,7 and angiotensin 4 to act on the 84 receptors. What is CAGE? CAGE is the chymase chymostatin sensitive angiotensin 2 converting enzyme. Okay, chymase chymostatin sensitive angiotensin 2 generating converting enzyme. So that means angiotensin 2 can be generated by two mechanisms. One, through the cleavage of angiotensin 1 by the ACE enzyme, removing of two amino acids and producing your classical pathway of the angiotensin. Okay, and now, the other one is the CAGE pathway. I told you what is CAGE. So that is a very important thing. This is the point I wanted you to pick up from this article. I did not think that you will miss this diagram. This is such an important one. So what are these? This is the classical one and the pathway. And then second one is the CAGE pathway. The third one is the ACE3 and the production of this one. These are important for us. And we have what are called the earlier days, we were only thinking of vascular or endothelial. Some disturbance is coming. Somebody's mic is open. Okay. So earlier days, we were all thinking that there is an intravascular endothelial function only. But this angiotensin system is active in the kidney, in the heart, and in the blood vessels. And needless to say, the central role is played by the kidney as well as the vasculature. So that is what these people are bringing in here. And if you read further, you get the... Okay, here. How does it affect proteinuria? How does it affect the local RAS? That is called the systemic RAS and local RAS. Local RAS means in the tissue RAS, tissue RAAS. Now you can see here, this is the mechanism through which it will be affecting your dynamics in the kidney. Proteinuria, tubular transport, growth of glomerular and tubular cells, inhibition of nitric oxide synthesis, metabolic effects, increase in the tubular HDL and albumin uptake, stimulation of ECF matrix synthesis, and then inhibition of extracellular matrix turnover, upregulation of TOL4 receptors, induction of the chemokines, induction of the reactive oxygen species, glomerular hemodynamics by affecting the afferent and efferent arterioles, and apoptosis of the tubular cells, and of course the proteinuria. So there's so many mechanisms. This is another important diagram from this article, apart from the one I showed. There's one more here, but that is already a known diagram to all of you. That is not much. The angiotensin II ran into angiotensin II. This is in the vasculature, we know, but in the tubular lumen also, the same thing happens. Okay, in the tubular lumen, this is the interstitium. This is the principal cell. So this ACE works the lumen. Does it work within the cell? This has been discussed in this particular article. In addition to proteinuria, what are the other effects that the ACE system can produce? Just go through the article and you see a lot of information on local RAS, of course. We considered growth and growth factors and apoptosis. And then you have got fibrosis and inflammation. So angiotensin II is a powerful promoter of inflammation and fibrosis. And blocking the angiotensin II by various mechanisms can be anti-inflammatory and anti-fibrotic and anti-proliferative and anti-aldosterone. So now inhibition of ROS and AT1 receptors independent of the ROS. Instead of blocking the RAS, can we block the system using the various other mechanisms, like other than the classical RAS pathway, the cage pathway, and the alternate ACE2 pathway? Okay, so these are the various things that which are new. I thought you should be learning. So now summarize, Arun, what are the things we need to learn from this article? One, I'm summarizing again, note down all of you. One, the classical pathway is no more the only pathway. There are other pathways. What are they? As you can see here, this diagram is very essential. The chymase dependent cage pathway, the ACE2 pathway, and production of angiotensin 1,7, which is a different in molecular structures. It is one more amino acid less than the angiotensin 2. Okay, because at the first level, it only one amino acid was cleaved, and here two more amino acids are cleaved. Total three are removed. Whereas angiotensin II, only two amino acids are removed. And then, of course, the angiotensin IV mechanism. So, number one, classical ACE. Number two, the chymase and cage pathway. Number three, ACE2 pathway, resulting in angiotensin 1,7 and angiotensin II further breaking down into angiotensin IV. Which acts on the AT4 receptors. This you have to pick up. And the second thing is you have to also pick up the multiple effects on the level of the kidney. This is called the tissue RAS or the local RAAS. There is a systemic RAS, there is a local RAS, the how does that produce this particular schematic diagram represents how angiotensin 2 can be deleterious to the kidney, and how blocking the angiotensin 2 can be very protective to the kidney. That is why, needless to say, a patient of kidney disease or patient of diabetes, proteinuria, the first drug that comes to mind is ARB, even better than ACE. And then what did we learn? Growth factors and apoptosis, inflammation, anti-inflammatory effect, anti-fibrotic effect, and anti-aldosterone effect, and non-ACE or non-classical pathway independent of the ROS, the other pathway we have to think about. And when you come to heart failure, you have the natriuretic peptides, and you not only you block the ROS on one side, you also block the natriuretic peptides on the other side by a drug called sacubitril, which is a combination of the natriuretic peptide pathway blocker as well as the classical angiotensin receptor blocker, the valsartan. So that we learned when we learned heart failure, and these are the learning points from this article.